the head of MAN Transport Solutions. Please receive Stefan Sahlmann.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for sharing your time with me. So on such a hot day, Friday afternoon. Yes, a short message.
To its responsibility for the fight against climate change. Reducing greenhouse gas emissions is one of MAN's most important corporate goals. That is why at least half of our vehicles sold in the EU should have an emission-free drive system by the end of this decade. From 2040, all new commercial vehicles sold by MAN will be free of fossil fuels. And by 2050, at the latest, MAN wants to be completely greenhouse gas neutral on balance sheet. That is net zero emission along the entire value chain.
Yeah, what a strong message from our MAN CEO, Alexander Flaskamp. In a nutshell, by 2030, we want to sell over 50% of our vehicles in the EU with zero-emission drivetrain. By 2040, all drivetrain technologies we will offer will be free of fossil fuel. And by 2050, the complete value chain of MAN will be greenhouse gas neutral on balance sheet. My name is Stefan Sahlmann. I'm the head of MAN Transport Solutions, and I would like to use the next couple of minutes to share with you some information and give you a look inside how MAN is going to do that and what are the big milestones we have ahead of us. Why we have to act, I think it's not a question. There's not too much time to spend when we look at the global warming. Even if we only would go for the 2 degrees global warming target, there's no budget for the CO2 left and no time to lose. Therefore, we have to act now. And having a look on the right side of the slide, you can see the impact of the transport industry and the transport sector of the CO2 emission. Globally, roughly 1/6 of the CO2 emissions is produced by the transport sector. And when you go look at the EU, even 29% of the all-over emissions of the EU are produced by the transport sector, the private and the commercial one. And thereof, 1/3 is coming from the commercial vehicle industry. Therefore, we as MAN, as producer for commercial vehicles, for truck, bus and vans, as well as for external engines, feel a special responsibility to act here and to provide our solution and our part to be part of the solution. Having a deeper look inside MAN, where does the CO2 emissions along the value chain come from? First, you have, based on the science-based target initiative definition, you have 3 scopes. The first scope are the indirect emissions. So these are including the purchase of materials we use to produce our vehicles. Here, a little bit more than 2% of the emissions are coming from. A very small bucket is the scope 1 and 2. These are the indirect emissions and the emissions coming from energy, different sources, electric energy, heating, cooling, steam, everything we use for the production. So this is only 0.2 emission percent. And nearly 98% of the emissions we are producing indirectly are the emissions of the vehicles in use with our customers all over the lifetime. And therefore it's clear that is where we have to be active. We have to find solutions and offer solutions to the industry, to our customers, to be able to turn their business into an even more sustainable solution. And therefore we are focusing specially, not only, but specially on this scope 3 downstream business. As mentioned, MAN is committed to the science-based targets initiative, with a focus of the 1.5 Celsius degrees global warming target to avoid that. And therefore, our target is to save 70% of the CO2 emissions in the scope 1 and 2 area and 28% of the emissions in the scope 3, compared 2019 to the year 2030. How do we get there? The negative effect is when you switch the technology from combustion engine vehicles to battery electric vehicles, the CO2 emissions of the production materials are doubling. So due mainly to the batteries you have to use. Therefore, it's one of our main targets to use only battery cells produced with renewable energy only. And the same we have also in focus for other materials like steel and polymer. For our production sites, we already reduced 30% of our CO2 emissions since 2008 at our production sites. And our target is to get neutral free completely by 2030. And in the future, we will only buy green energy for all our net sales network worldwide. We are talking here about of a couple of hundred sites all over the world. And finally, coming to the third and most important bucket is the vehicle. As already mentioned, over 50% of the vehicles we will sell in the EU by 2030 will be battery electric, so zero emission. And as I mentioned just, the battery electric technology is the prime path for us to electrify the transportation sector. Because it has the by far highest energy efficiency compared to other sources. Other alternatives for zero emission could be interesting for special application, but the mainstream for the truck as well for the bus business and the transporter business from our perspective is battery electric technology. And beside the offering of battery electric vehicles in the future, we are also working very strong and focusing to offer much more beyond the vehicle. So we are talking about solutions and services that enable our customers to easily transform their business. Because as you can imagine, and there will come some more details in the next slides, it's much more than just buying an electric vehicle. And therefore, we want to support our customers right from the beginning to have all solutions available right in time to have a smooth transformation and a safe transformation for their business. Because our customers have to earn money by running the vehicles. It's not just having fun driving an e-tron outside. I love the e-tron, I drive one by myself, but I don't have to earn money with it. Coming to our vehicle portfolio, most of the vehicle you can really touch and feel live here at the festival. For example, the ETGE we introduced 2018 to the market is already the number 3 of zero emission transporters in Europe. With this transporter, we fully fulfill all requirements of the classical last mile delivery. Here at the festival, we are doing the logistics behind the scenes for this festival with this zero emission technology. And the good thing with this vehicle, operating in the inner city, you have the complete positive impact of zero emission. Zero emission CO2, no noise, no particles from the drivetrain, and no NOx from the drivetrain. So therefore, here really, as an inhabitant of a city, you can be happy if all the last mile delivery would be electric in the future. Staying in the city, we have the public transport, a very important sector, and it's one of our main targets and focus to electrify the public transport in the next couple of years. Therefore, we introduced 2020 already the MN Line City. You can use here at the festival as a shuttle service, also as a 12-meter and 80-meter version. And already with our current product portfolio and battery technology, we nearly fulfill all requirements regarding range of our customers in Europe. But when in 2 years' time from now on, we will introduce the new battery generation, we will even extend the range of our batteries by 30%. So then there will no application anymore that cannot be covered by the MN Line City electric city bus. And before coming to the next slide, then we are not just focusing on the urban transport in Europe, but also abroad. Therefore, in 2024, based on the city bus technology, we will introduce our completely new developed e-chassis. The chassis is a platform including the axles and the drivetrain and the batteries, so that based on this platform, tailored, localized chassis body solutions can build up in all countries all over the world, in left drive hand and right hand drive. So then we will have the complete portfolio for the city bus all over the world. Before coming to the next slide, Outside, you can see already the ETGM. It's used as the music stage for the green beats. This was our small series electric truck. We introduced the first of them in 2018 already. And since then, we introduced several small fleets all over Europe to gain experience together with our customers and learn what does it mean to electrify logistics. And with 2024, we will introduce our first serial long haul and distribution truck from MAN with a range between 600 and 800 kilometers. And this truck will be ready for megawatt charging. So as soon as the standard is defined and implemented and available along the routes, this truck will be able to cover the operations and the range demands of our customers in the full extent. And here I come to a very important point. We as OEM mainly can focus on the development of zero emission drivetrains, in this case battery electric vehicles. But it's much more than only providing the vehicle. There are three pillars. Beside the vehicle, we need the charging network. The charging network must be installed and must be in place before our customers can really run their business without any influences. And therefore, here it's important that the public sector, the politicians also pave the way that this charging network will be rolled out. And the third pillar that is even much more important is it only makes sense to run electric vehicles if you have renewable green energy. And therefore, this sector also has to provide their part to make transportation really sustainable. So these three things, the electric vehicle, the charging network, and the energy sector together, they have to work together and joint effort really make transportation sustainable. But as mentioned before, MAN is going one step ahead. We are providing our customers not only with the right portfolio of vehicles, but also supporting them with experience and help answering all the questions they have when thinking about the electrification of their hubs and depots. With MAN Transport Solutions, our consultancy service we introduced in 2018, we are consulting customers right from the beginning and support them to step into e-mobility without any open questions. We really analyze the existing network, the operation with diesel-driven vehicles, and then show them the plan how to transform this fleet operation into electromobility. This includes the range calculation and the calculation of the energy consumption. What is the right charging strategy? What kind of charging infrastructure do I need? Until when do I have to ramp this up? So what are the electrification steps of my fleet? Because no customer, if he has more than one vehicle, will transfer the complete fleet in one step. So there is a stepwise transformation. And finally, also the energy is important. Where do I get my energy from? How much energy do I need? What are the peaks and how can I avoid the peaks and I can avoid and optimize the cost of the energy? All these questions are provided by the MAN Transport Solutions consulting team. So we are giving, we're helping our customer not being afraid stepping into a zero emission technology and to electrify their operation. By doing that, we have consulted over 200 customers since 2018 in the transport, in the public, in the logistic, last mile delivery segment, and in the public transport segment, all of Europe and in a selected market outside Europe. So these are just some of our customers we have consulted, and all the experience we got from these 200, over 200 consultancy, we bring into the new cases of new customers and share our experience with them to have a really safe and secure transformation. The second big question mark behind the vehicle and the range is the topic charging. And therefore, we partnered with three different charging infrastructure partners and producers, ABB, Heliox, and Schaltbau, to be able not only to provide the charging strategy and the charging plan, infrastructure plans to our customers, but also to be able to provide the right charging infrastructure, including its installation and maintenance. And therefore, our customer can really cover the two solve the biggest question mark, the right vehicle, the right and the right charging infrastructure out of one hand. And as mentioned before, one thing is the charging infrastructure in the depot. It's not easy, but it's able to install that by doing your own calculation and then purchasing the right infrastructure. But when it comes to long haul transportation, it's important to have the right infrastructure available along the routes. And therefore, MAN, together with the sister brand Scania and with our main competitors, Daimler Trucks and the Volvo Group, we formed a joint venture to ramp up a public charging network and to give the right impulse to the industry that this is necessary to build these charging points up. And within the next 5 years, this consortium will build up over 1,700 high-power charging points and spend over 500 million euro to give the first impulse to this network. It will be not enough, but it is the first impulse, and now we hope that other players are also going in the same direction, and then we will be able to offer our customers, our common customers in the market, the right, efficient charging network they need for their operation. But we think also beyond the operation of the vehicle. When it comes to battery technologies, there's always a question, is this the right technology? Don't we produce a lot of waste? And here we say, no, we are thinking how to use the battery as long as possible. And if the first life is over in the vehicle, then we try to find solution for the two of the three most important sustainability criteria, reuse and recycling. The reuse of the vehicle could be done in two ways. One time, we looking for repair concepts, how to repair and maybe take out modules of the battery that are, had a failures and really repair the battery in the way that it can be used another time for a second vehicle life. If that is not possible, we are currently cooperating with different companies to build up solutions for energy storage to use these used vehicles and give them a second life as a storage, energy storage stationary outside the vehicle and really extend the lifetime of the batteries. And after that, if recycling is the last way, we are working and defining clear processes how to secure to bring back the battery to our factories and then using the recycling network also from the Volkswagen Group we are part of and really having as high recycling quote as possible and bring back the material back to the production of for new batteries. That is how we care for using the battery technology in the most extended way. And we are glad that we are not have to do that all the investigation investment alone. We are part of the Traton Group together with our sister brands Scania, Navistar from the US and Volkswagen Camiones from Brazilian market. And together with our sister brand Rio, the digital daughter, we are together investigating in investing in the new technologies. Not only in technologies like drivetrains, new battery generations, but also in new services and solutions. And this is our aim as a group to invest our limited resources in the best way by using synergies, the investment and the expertise, the experts we have in all of our brands for a portfolio we can offer to our customers to give them the complete all elements of the ecosystem being prepared for the transformation of their business. In a nutshell, we care by offering sustainable solutions. By offering tailored and individual solutions to the challenges, the individual challenges of each customer. And to help our customer to run the business lucrative. Because we believe the key to success for sustainability is not only to make the transport CO2 neutral, but also profitable. Only if something's profitable, our customer are able and willing to transform their fleet from diesel technology to zero emission. And therefore, this is our target to provide all these necessary solutions to our customers and therefore we commit to the CO2 avoiding target. Tailored green technology to electrify and simplify the global transportation. That's the target of MAN, and I hope I could give you a short look inside how we're doing that and what are our activities. So if you have further questions, please let me know. I'm happy to answer, if possible.
Before the questions, we would like to thank you for presenting. Welcome. And now we look at the room. questions for Stefan.
Fast.
Of course.
Oh my God.
It's all about speed
here. No time,
efficiency.
Yeah, the consortium that was created for the megawatt charging, does it have a name?
Not yet. Till end of the month, we hope that all the legal topics will be clarified, and then officially it will be named, placed. Next month.
And it will install charging infrastructure and operate it as a CPO as well.
Exactly. They will install the charge points and charge parks all over Europe, and then operate all them also.
Nice. Thanks.
Okay. More questions from the audience.
Yeah, thanks so much for the presentation. Fantastic to hear what's going on in the heavy transport industry. I was actually interested that you showed a figure, I think 270 to 320 kilometers for your electric buses. What does that compare to a bus driver's shift? Is that a full shift?
Yes. The requirements from our customers in the inner city segment are varying between 100, 150 up to 350, 400 sometimes. Therefore, we are currently able to cover maybe 85-90% of these requirements, and with the new technology it shouldn't be a problem to cover all these ranges, especially under special conditions, very hot countries, cold countries where you have heating, and heating does only make sense with electric heating, and finally also the topography is also important too. So driving in winter in Switzerland could be very challenging, and therefore it's necessary to have also the right capacity on board.
Right.
Yeah, I was just wondering as well, do you have a ticket in for hydrogen for heavy transport? Because I know some companies are betting on that to a certain extent.
For hydrogen, what we are doing is we are doing some basic development on that, and research especially for hydrogen to keep in the industry knowing what's going on. But our prime path is battery electric, and up to now we see really that there's a huge coverage of battery electric technology for nearly all application. There will be some, and then in the future we will decide if we step into this small segment that cannot be covered or if we do not. But we are doing a research on that, yes.
Thanks very much.
Okay. There's a question in the back too, then here.
Okay. Thank you. So I was stepping in a little bit late, so I hope I understood it right. You're also thinking about recycling used batteries to reuse it then in the operation. The question is, how do you identify the limit when you say you take the batteries out of the vehicles and then recycle the materials to get it back into the life cycle? Do you have a threshold that you use?
What we are doing is, that's a complete new field for us, that's for true. But what we're doing is we have a very detailed analysis and tracking of the battery data. So we know all of the batteries that are the markets and in operation, what is the state of health, and how is the curve, the state of health, developing. And then we can decide, depending on the requirements of the customer, when is the right point in time to change the battery. Sometimes you can take out a battery from a customer's car which has a very high range demands and place it at the customer cars maybe who is just driving the school bus service running 80-100 kilometers per day instead of 350. Or we decide this battery is not good enough anymore for the vehicle operation, but maybe for the storage.
Am I allowed a follow-up?
Yeah, you can.
Follow-up question on that one. So you're offering this service of monitoring, battery monitoring also to your customers, or is this something that you are doing in the back and then you contact your customers, hey, we did the monitoring and now is the time to change and please here come to us and we do the recycling?
The favor of our customer is to get a guarantee of the lifetime of the battery. And they say, we have been using the electric bus, for example, for 12 years. Now we want want to do the same with the electric bus. So it's on us to guarantee this lifetime of the vehicle. And in the background, we have to decide, is the one battery good enough for 12 years or maybe has to be replaced after 8 years? So in the background, we have to track them and secure that the operation of our customer is safe.
Okay, so I hope that answers your question. Okay, then we have a question here.
You said that you have already consulted about 200 companies all around Europe. How many of those have you successfully consulted, meaning that they're planning to transform their fleet or already bought vehicles or planning to?
I would say we have a quite huge success rate. The question is, how do you define success? We are not selling the vehicles, but we are in the pre-sales phase, so we are really consulting the customer who are thinking about e-mobility and want to know what questions do I have to answer for myself. And certainly we are here close in cooperation with our sales guys, but in the public transport sector, for example, then there must be there are official tenders. So if you consult a customer, he is not able to say, okay, good consultancy, I will buy your vehicle as well. So they have to do that in the public tender. Therefore, our success is if we could convince a customer what is the right time and what is the right strategy to switch to e-mobility, and if we could convince him from the right technology, the right charging technology, the right configuration of the vehicle. If we then sell it in the second step, that's not our responsibility. We hope for that, certainly, and support that, but we cannot influence that directly. But most of our customers, we can say, and afterwards, if you will have some more detailed questions, here's Michael Fall, my colleague, who is the head of Transport Solutions Consulting. The main issue is really to convince the customer is what I do have to prepare for myself and what is the right way forward to go for e-mobility. And therefore, we have a quite high hit rate.
Okay. We got a question here as well. Over there, okay.
Yeah. 2024 announcement, there was 600 to 800 kilometers. What exactly does that announcement imply? Will it be ready, already a vehicle that can do all this range, or you will start developing it? I didn't catch the milestone. And also megawatt charging ready. How far will the infrastructure already be?
I don't know if I get the question right, but I think we are developing, the vehicle development is going on, certainly, and we are having the first prototypes already running. One of the trucks you have seen, we brought to Berlin a couple of weeks ago with Mr. Wissinger to test it. It was the first public ride. The range is certainly depending, and the truck business is long on the a lot on the payload. And our target is not, if we certainly plan to extend the range of our vehicles in the second step, but not only by putting even more batteries in the vehicle, because at the end you will only transport batteries instead of goods. The story is that you need this high power charging network and then really charge the vehicle while the driver has to make his legal pause. So after 4.5 hours, a driver has to make a break for 45 minutes, and exactly these 45 minutes must be enough for charging the vehicle fully, or maybe 80%, depending on the range for the rest of the day. And this is what we're aiming for, to have the right charging technology for the vehicle available, so that we can go up to 800 kilowatt performance or even higher, and then to enable our customer or the driver to recharge the vehicle in the short break he has to make.
It's not one charge 800 kilometers, right?
This is
an aggressive target.
That's aggressive. It will be a little bit less, but you can calculate by your own, and this depends, but also on the topography and especially on the load payload, how far you can drive in 4.5 hours with the truck. So it will be roughly about 500 kilometers you can ride.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? Here we have a question.
Hi. The advantage of a truck is the long lifetime. And you have a very strong second and third market for used trucks. And I think this concept is significantly changing how the second and the third life will be of that truck. Are you considering also how to act there, how to ensure that, well, the trucks that we have right now are not going to second and third world countries and remain there forever and then pollute the environment forever? But also, are you also thinking about solutions for those markets to come, for the future life of those electrical trucks?
That's a very good question. And Yes, we don't have the solution now, but we know that there will be a huge change and that we will not be able to serve our typical second or third markets with the battery technology right from the beginning because they are not prepared for. So if a truck, for example, goes to eastern or southern countries or maybe to Africa nowadays, this won't be able with the first battery electric vehicles. So we have to look for solutions to keep these vehicles in the market but not to be too competitive for the new vehicle sales. So yes, this will be tricky, but we think about that, but we don't have the solution right now how this will really change the complete currently existing typical market mechanisms.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
So you just mentioned the part that he has to take a break of 45 minutes. Do you have statistics how long the truck is loading and unloading? And do you support the, not the carriers itself, but the persons that are using the trucks for transportation in your consulting? And are you considering that?
We are considering if we know or if we see from the charging strategy and the usage strategy of the vehicle that it would make sense, especially in the distribution segment where one truck is maybe delivering goods from one supermarket to the other every 30 kilometers, that this time could be used at the in the unloading process, for example. But then we can define the strategy what kind of infrastructure should have been to be installed at the customer site or the supermarket, for example, and how much energy could be charged within this period of time to the vehicle. So these are scenarios we are working out for the customer if it makes sense, but then it's certainly more a discussion between the logistic company and the supermarket to get the energy there. From normally they have the energy supply in this sites, and this shouldn't be too difficult, but it's always a question about who is doing the investment and who is open for that. And therefore, I think the acceptance and the willingness to transform the complete industry is not only on our customer side, it must be also in the in the society that we are asking. I want to have more green logistics, and certainly also to find the customer between, like the supermarket, to be open for that. I invest and do my part also to enable green logistics.
Just taking that point up, I think it's part of the solution that whenever the truck is stopping, it should be able to be charged. And therefore, we could reduce the downtimes because that's the money. And I think the BayWa in Bavaria had a use case where they needed 23 minutes for loading and unloading of the truck, and in 20 minutes they could charge the next step or the next load. Yep. And I would like to see that since we are also buying a few trucks for transportation, taking that in mind and giving us that solution and the opportunity would help us for the solution making and decision making in the future.
Yeah, that's a very good hint. And what we have done or what is able in that and what we already thought about, it would be really good to have maybe a talk to Michael because he's deep in that topic, and then we could share the information what kind of solutions and models we have been thinking about in our customers as well in the past.
Thank you very much. We go immediately there.
Yeah, I wonder how do you see the grids, the distribution grids being prepared for all this megawatt charging? Do we need to even go to the high voltage lines? Did you run all the numbers?
Sometimes I'm happy I'm not in the energy industry because it's their problem. No, that's our common problem and challenge to solve that. That's the reason why it's such important to think about clever solutions when to charge. For example, really using every break and stopping time that you maybe charge several times over the day, but the thing is, including all these different charging breaks and times, it cannot be to make the day for the driver more complex than it is already today. Because so you have to find smooth solutions where the operator and the driver is really willing to use all these opportunities and maybe reduce then the demand for high power charging and specific spots where already another 50 trucks are already waiting for. But this could be in some spots really challenging to bring the right energy there for. And therefore, I was also happy to see outside some energy solutions that could be work autark, maybe for the intermediate time until the energy supply could be provided, because this can really take years. We talk about not months, we talk about years, and therefore we shouldn't stop this transformation now to wait that every player in the market is ready. So you have to find intermediate solutions and flexible solutions that maybe can be used for the next couple of years and then maybe then can be replaced.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have space for one more question. And I'm going once, going twice, right at the top.
It's just a comment, actually, but I love the green beats idea. We had a great dance party out there last night, so thanks for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, indeed. So,
thank you.
That's all the space we had for questions. You know, I would like to thank you again for being here today. And now, give a proper applause to Stefan Sahlmann.
Exactly. Thank you for being here.